साक्षी, आर यू देयर?
यस मैम, जस्ट अ मिनट.
अच्छा साक्षी, जस्ट अ थिंग, यू मेक श्योर दैट यू टेक अ फोटोग्राफ व्हेन एवरीवन्स वीडियो इज ऑन व्हाइल वी आर देयर.
ओके मैम.
या
Good morning, everyone. We welcome you to the fifth episode of One and Only Mike and Mike with Aurangabad Vikasa. As they say, an investment in knowledge pays off the best interest. So here we are to learn about stock markets and investments. We are very grateful to have Abhijit Bothra sir and CA Anish Chitre sir today. Now, I would like to call our Aurangabad Vikasa chairperson, CA Rupali Bothra ma'am, for her opening address.
Yes, thank you, Sakshi and Rajasi. Firstly, I would like to welcome C. Anish Chitray and Mr. Abhijit Bothra to our episode 5 of this podcast series on behalf of Aurangabad as well as Nashik branch of Vikasa. This time, we have been trying to bring up various topics in this podcast series. The idea behind was so that the sessions become interactive instead of one way. So we thought this kind of an interview sessions would really be interesting for the students. And this time, the topic being capital market, we thought, why not have a talk show with two speakers and two hosts to bring up something, to add up to the spice of the podcast series. We just thought of this idea and would really like to appreciate my team for their efforts put in. They have been working for it for almost 10 to 12 days since now. So would really like to appreciate their efforts. And so welcome and thank you, Piyush sir, for joining with us. Yes, thank you. Over to you, Sakshi.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I would like to call Nashik Vikasa chairperson, CA Piyush Chandak sir, for his opening address.
Thank you, Sakshi. And first of all, thanks a lot, Rupali ma'am, to let us join with Aurangabad branch of Vikasa for this novel idea you are doing. I have been following your first four episodes of podcast and I really liked the concept, and it is really good to know And I am experiencing that since the day one your Deccan Charge, that your students are so active and doing a lot of work for you and for the Aurangabad branch of Vikasa. And I think definitely students are gaining a lot who are doing work. They must be gaining a lot from these activities, because ultimately it is for the benefit of the students only. You work, you know, you learn, and definitely you excel. And about the program, I would like to share only one thing with the students, that you are having two great speakers with you, and definitely you will be learning the techniques and everything about capital markets. But the only thing in capital markets is to handle is FOMO, that is fear of missing out. Because people, I have seen people, being a chartered accountant practicing since last 15, 16 years, I have seen clients that in this FOMO, they take wrong entries and wrong exits, and they, instead of making money, they make losses. And definitely those two great people will be for throwing light on this aspect also. And with this, I'll thank again to Aurangabad Vikasa for this great program, and welcome both of the hosts and both speakers. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.
Just a minute, Sakshi. Thank you, Pure sir, for your kind words. Just to mention, ये जो joint programs करने का idea है ये हमको Pure sir से ही मिला है, and we are happy that we are doing such programs jointly with you for the benefit of the students, so that maximum students can have access to the knowledge of the speakers that we are hearing. That's it. I and Pure sir would be leaving the podcast, and Sakshi and Rajasi would be continuing with both of you speakers. So we won't be there for the vote of thanks. Would like to thank both the speakers once again for your valuable time. Thank you very much. Yes.
Thank you, Pure sir. Thank you, Rupali ma'am. Now I would like to introduce our guest. Abhijit Bothra sir is the franchise owner of Motilal Oswal Securities Limited at Aurangabad for past 21 years. He has been handling the portfolio of 1400 clients with a total asset under management value of rupees 700 crores. Yes, you heard me right, rupees 700 crores. He's a regular visiting faculty for MBA students at various colleges in Aurangabad and provides advisory services on investments in capital markets, derivatives, currency and commodities trading, and mutual fund investments.
And our today's second speaker, CA Anish Chitra sir, is a qualified chartered accountant, chartered alternate investment analyst, and an information system auditor. He is also pursuing his CFA level 2 and diploma in business management and finance. And related to the market, he has been empaneled as a resource person for conduction of investor awareness program with ICAI. He has also co-authored investment awareness guidance notes for ICAI. He has also conducted many seminars and lectures relating to capital market. And he has been trading since his age of 18.
We welcome both the speakers, and now brace yourself as we start our session.
Can you both please tell us about your journey in stock market? Apart from money, which thing about stock market attracts you the most? Abhijit sir, you can go first.
Sir, you are on mute.
Mute.
Sorry, very sorry. Hello, Vikasa Aurangabad, the branch of ICA. Firstly, I would like to thank Aurangabad chairperson and the Nasik chairperson of Vikasa Group for giving me this opportunity to have a podcast with the Vikasa students of Nasik and Aurangabad branch. Hello, Anish.
Good morning.
Welcome you also. So as far as my journey in the stock markets is concerned, see, basically I started my career in the stock market investment field right from the age of, 16 or 17 years, since my father and my family were investing in the stock markets. And after that, during my articleship in Pune, I used to visit one or two clients at my office in Pune. And from there, I got attracted towards the stock market, the investment and related money market instruments. I used to visit Bombay Stock Exchange Ring at that time also, even at the Pune Stock Exchange. And this is how I got entered into the stock market, my career field. And eventually, I approached Motilal Oswal Securities Limited. The name was Motilal Oswal Securities Limited that time. Now it is Motilal Oswal Financial Services Limited. And since at the and I started the franchise of Motilal Oswal Financial Services Limited at my very early age of 22. So it's approximately 20-21 years in this business as a stock broker and financial advisor. And as and when the now the market has been grown and progressed, so I've seen all the ups and downs of the stock market. When I started these my franchise business, the Sensex was, today it is at 52,000 odd levels. At that time it was 2400. That is just it. That's right. It's 20 times now, approximately 20 times from those levels. So this is how my journey in the stock market is.
Anish sir, your journey, please.
Yeah. First of all, I would like to thank ma'am and PU sir for having me on this podcast. So I'll just continue. So my father was a long-term investor and I had firsthand seen the power of the markets and the massive compounding it was capable of. Thus, as a youngster and as a student of CA, I was always attracted towards the market. As soon as I turned 18, the first thing I did after obviously getting my four-wheeler license was to open a DMAT account. And being a newbie, you know the routine. First, I was a newbie short-term trader slash agar loss ho gaya toh long-term value investor. So my routine started from there. So at first, I started buying flashy stocks recommended on TV, tips given on online market or online forums by such savvy investors. And second, then I started consuming knowledge from books like Intelligent Investor and so on. One of the things that also was a part of my routine was posting stock markets course on Insta and posting my new profits and losses on Insta as well. Because if you are doing something like stock market, then in young age, one of the habits is that you have to update first, first story post. So I had gone through all that routine. So at first I started with share market, that is equity investing. And then with time, I soon started doing futures. Then I even dabbled in currency and I then started doing options. However, I had always been a very ordinary trader. Kabhi profit hota tha, kabhi loss hota tha. So as such, aisa consistency aisa kuch nahi tha mere trading mein. So I began thinking that, see, I am devoting a substantial amount of my time towards trading. So in the return, I'm just getting, okay, market ordinary beta returns. So just to clarify, there are basically two types of returns in the market. One is beta return, that is the overall market return. And second is the alpha return. So alpha return is basically whatever you earn due to your trading, which is over and above the market return. So I thought ki abar mujhe beta return hi chahiye aur ordinary waisa mera hai. So itna time devote karne se achha, I could just go and buy some mutual funds and be done with it. So that's when I was dabbling around, I came across technical analysis. And since then, I have never looked back. So technical trading or technical analysis has given me a system by which I started managing my risk and reward consistently. Nowadays, in the world of technical trading, the buzzword is the algos. So which is basically, you code your computer to trick trades on your behalf on the basis of logic which you follow. Right now, in NSE and BSE, almost 65% of trades are done through algos. Basically, algos are deployed by big investors and institutional investors. So when you're trading in the market, there is a high probability that you are trading or you're competing against a computer who has 100 times more knowledge than you and who can take decisions and execute the same at lightning speed. Luckily, in the group of my friends, there were some CAs, there were some engineers. So few of them knew how to code. So it was pretty easy to convince them, kya re, chalo ek algo banate hai, apna pehle pas knowledge to hai hi, to algo ban hi jayenge. So it took around one and a half years for us to build an algo. So right now in my short journey, we are right now in the phase of deploying algos live in the market. So this has been my journey so far. Yes.
Thank you, sir. In today's uncertain world, how important do you think it is to save and invest money? What do you think whether COVID and lockdown has forced people to think about their financial savings and investment? Abhijit sir, what are your views on it?
See, basically, today's generation of your age is seeing COVID. When I was at your age, I had seen the Akshardham attacks. That time, I had seen the oil prices hike boom. At that time, I had seen the Kargil war. So, when my father was starting investing in stock markets, he has seen the Harshad Mehta scam. When I started investing, I again saw the Ketan Parekh scam in the markets. After that, one more scam, that IPO scam was that DMAT, multiple DMAT accounts and everything, that scam was there. Today's situation is of COVID. Previously, there were situations such as government changing from Manmohan Singh from Atal Bihari Vajpayee government to Manmohan Singh two terms. From there to Narendra Modi government two terms. Now this is the COVID situation. See, all these scenarios will be there. No doubt about it. Previously, it was Iran war, oil barrel, then Akshardham attacks, then 9/11 attacks on the World Trade Center that we all know. At that time, I think your generation might be hardly a year or two, or many of you might not have been born also at that time. So all these situations have happened, will happen, and they will continue. But one thing is there in all these scenario. One should see that he saves his investment. He invests properly in all type of asset classes. You should invest in stock markets. You should have a mutual fund SIP instead of lump sum investment. See, as of now, we are taking the seminar for the Vikasa students, for the young generation of your age, whatever. So you can start by seeing your monthly pocket money by investing in mutual funds. Or if you go further, you can start investing by taking good quality stocks in stock market, so that whenever such kind of situation happens, might it be today it's COVID, so it's a lockdown or everything, whatever, we are talking of COVID. Tomorrow, after say 3 years, 5 years, 10 years down the line, something might else be there. So again, there will be a crash and everything would be there. So financial investments or savings or financial investment should always be there to balance one's financial needs or financial requirements during such uncertain times. So there's nothing as such COVID or whatever, but one should have a systematic financial planning across throughout his life, so that whenever such uncertain situation comes, so you have proper investments and you can utilize those investments for your financial requirements in those difficult times.
Thank you, sir. Anish, sir, your views on it?
Yeah. As rightly said by Abhijit, sir, I would just like to add a few points. This is not just due to COVID. Saving and investing has always been of utmost importance. COVID has just fast-tracked this process of lack of financial planning. We have seen people have lost their jobs. There is a lack of income due to which people have started eating through their savings. They are unable to serve their huge EMIs. There are also n number of medical expenses which have eroded their investments. And several other heartwarming stories have been there. So this has generally triggered the need this year to start a process of wealth creation. There are generally two types of incomes in the market. One is the passive income and other is the active income. The active income is in which you work for money. So basically, it is your day job and whatever salary or whatever income you get from doing day-to-day activities. The second is the passive income, which is nothing but income you earn from your investments. So this is where the money works for you. If you have read the papers, you would have known that almost 10 million new DMAT accounts have been opened in last year itself. However, this is not due to sudden realization ki are abhi finance and planning karna padega. Yeah, they have suddenly got to know the importance of wealth planning. This is basically due to the blockbuster return given by the indexes in the last year, and which was also aided by people having money and sitting bored at home. So other than that, the FOMO, so the DMAT, a huge increase in DMAT account, other than this was due to the FOMO. So that is the fear of missing out, like Piyush sir said. So basically, it was always important. So we are seeing the thing. And I also believe that as and when the work from office resumes, the number of DMAT account will go dormant. So I believe the Abhijit sir would also agree with this.
This thing has already happened during the last, say, from September to approximately, say, January or February, where our revenues, my revenue was approximately down by around 30% a month. Now in the lockdown, it has again increased. We have again increased our revenue. So that's it. During the last 1 year or so, people had no work and multiple demat accounts were opened in the names of the family members and people who had money or some small savings or whatever. They had started investing and trading in the stock markets. So
that's a very interesting fact, sir.
Yes, that's a very, very interesting. And that's a, it's a not, it's interesting, but it for me as a business, let's say a business owner or a franchisee owner or a stockbroking business, my revenue was really down by, say, around 25% a month. So rather I was praising that there should be a lockdown once again so that my revenues would increase again. And it happened during the month of March, April and May. My revenues were increased drastically. They were almost doubled.
Right. So, as Albert Einstein has rightly said, compounding is the eighth wonder. Abhijit sir, so how can you explain us the power of compounding and why should everyone have an understanding of compounding? So they don't switch their DMAT accounts.
Compounding returns you get once when you have a systematic investment planning, say, or what, even whatever you call it, or whatever, say SIP or even systematic investment in the stock markets, monthly investment in the stock markets, then and only then you would be getting the compounding returns. Now, first of all, you'll need to understand what compounding is. See, what exactly compounding is. Suppose if you invest 100 rupees a month in 12 months, or say 1 lakh rupees per month in 12 months, it comes to 12 lakh a month. You get approximately, if you get around 16 to 18% or 18 to 20% return per month. And in the next year, such situation happens. There is a lockdown or any pandemic or anything, say war or anything. Happens, the market again crashes. But in that time, one should really keep his systematic investment or systematic planning in such a way that his investment, what he is making for the past 1 year, he doesn't disturb that investment. It is very, very important and it is very, very necessary that he keeps his investment throughout the year or throughout the cycle which he had planned for approximately 3 to 5 years. Then and only then he would be getting the benefit of compounding. Now, when you get the benefit of compounding is, say, suppose if you invest 1 lakh rupees a month and in the first year you get a return of around, say, 17 to 18% or 18 to 20% per year. In the next year, even if you invest, but your returns are not, say, 17 to 18%, might be your returns are negative. In the next year, your returns again might be a negative, but this is not the scenario that will go on continuing for around 3 years, 4 years, 5 years down the line. Once it will happen, your investments made in the second year or third year, their returns will increase drastically up as and when the market moves up in a V-shaped recovery. That is complete down and complete up. So once it's a U-shaped or V-shaped recovery, the returns which you had made when the markets were down will give you huge returns. Your investments will double, might be triple also in such a scenario of pandemic or COVID or any other thing. So suppose if you invest 1 lakh rupees per month for a year, 2 year, 3 year, compounding is first year 18%. So that is, say, suppose if you invest 10 lakh rupees in a year, so you at 18%, you get 1,80,000. Again, on 1,18,000, 18%, and again on that. So that is the compounding. So in a span of 3 years or 4 years down the line, your investment per annum investment becomes double. So that is the power of compounding. You get interest or you get returns as on the appreciation also. That is the power of compounding. But it is very necessary for that you keep your investments intact. You shouldn't get you shouldn't be feared by these kind of ups and downs in the markets. Then and only then the compounding ratio gives the returns. Otherwise, your compounding ratio won't pile up. Many times I have seen that people start investing, or clients or anybody, they start investing when the markets are up, but they exit, or they exit at rate to rate when the markets crash, because they are in fear ki yaar aage kaise hoga market aur crash hota hai jagah. This was the fear when last year the Nifty or the Sensex crashed heavily, say approximately more than 40%, approximately 35 to 40%. From a high of say 11,000, the markets crashed to 7,500. Many people are saying the stock market should be closed, everything should be closed, aise roz girte ja raha hai. But the people who had invested in those times, as Anish said, many a million, 10 million accounts had opened. And that is the thing, that's the basically reason. As money pumped in the markets flourished. All the good quality stocks, they flourished. Even the penny stocks are flourished, but penny stocks will keep that aside. But all the good companies are flourished. So fundamentals of a company won't be disturbed by these things. That is very sure.
So when you have money invested in market, ये market up and down से तो आपको फर्क पड़ने वाला है. So paper trading जैसे baby steps अगर हमने शुरुआत की तो कुछ help हो सकती है क्या? Anish sir?
So borrowing a cricketing analogy, see, paper trading is like doing net practice, and trading with your entire capital is like playing a international match or even playing a World Cup. So देखो अगर आप कोई net cricket से आप direct World Cup तो नहीं खेल सकते. बीच में आपको शायद डोमेस्टिक खेलना चाहिए, आईपीएल खेलना चाहिए, रणजी खेलना चाहिए. सो बेसिकली द क्रोनोलॉजी शुड बी दैट ओके यू कैन डू फर्स्ट पेपर ट्रेडिंग, देन स्टार्ट ट्रेडिंग विद स्मॉल परसेंटेज ऑफ योर टोटल ट्रेडिंग कैपिटल और टोटल टारगेट कैपिटल, एंड देन इन द थर्ड स्टेज यू कैन डिप्लॉय योर एंटायर कैपिटल. सी पेपर ट्रेडिंग टू सम एक्सटेंट इज यूजफुल, बट इट विल हेल्प यू जस्ट टू टेस्ट योर थियरीज. सी द मेन थिंग अबाउट ट्रेडिंग इज टू डेवलप अ टेम्परामेंट और टू डेवलप अ गट, which can only be developed by spending some time in the market. The main crux is, it's like, see, it's very, very easy to say that I bought a share in paper trading and it gave me a 100% return. But in reality, I tell you, 99% of these traders would have exited the stock by the time it had shot up to 10%. So if you are judging your accuracy on basis of paper trading, you are in for a shock. See, success in market is a combination of knowledge and emotional management. Paper trading doesn't teach you emotional management. Emotional management, from my point of view, is even greater than your knowledge. कैसे है, like if I take an example, ICI के mock test में fail होने से इतना कुछ फर्क नहीं पड़ता, पर actual exam में fail होने से जो दर्द होता है ना, वही आपको सिखाता है. तो वो जब तक दर्द नहीं होगा आपको, जब तक actual में loss का फटका नहीं बैठेगा, तब तक वो मजा या फिर आपका जो टेम्परामेंट है वो डेवलप नहीं होगा. एंड फॉर द सेकंड क्वेश्चन, दैट व्हाट द बेसिक कैपिटल यू शुड स्टार्ट विद, सी दिस इज क्वाइट सब्जेक्टिव. सो व्हाटएवर इज योर रिस्क एपेटाइट और व्हाटएवर यू कैन स्टैंड टू लूज, आप उस नए कैपिटल के साथ स्टार्ट कर सकते हो. द मेन थिंग इज दैट यू शुडंट लूज योर स्लीप ओवर समथिंग लाइक मार्केट. सो दैट शुड बी केप्ट इन माइंड.
Great example, sir. Abhijit sir, according to you as a beginner, how much important do you think it is to know about fundamental and technical analysis?
See, basically fundamental and technical analysis both are different things altogether. As a beginner, technical analysis is a very, very tough thing to study. You need a lot of time, lots of patience, and lot of studies are involved. There are different various kinds of charts and various kinds of theories are there in technical analysis, which you have to study in the stock markets. It takes almost 2 years, 2.5 years, might be 3 years. And then again, research is continued in these type of theories. There are various n number of softwares are available across the, they are available on the net, they are available on the market also. So if you want to have a career in this or a hardcore investor or a full-time job trading only, or you want to earn from trading, then and only then it is very advisable to have to go in for such technical research or technical studies. Because even after spending 20-21 years in the markets and having a good knowledge of the technical charts and technical analysis and studies, many a times, not many a times, I would say maximum of the times, as Anish said, today 60-65% of the trading has been done on algo theories and everything. They are using technical, it's purely on the technical analysis. As when they get the software pumps up, as who are buying, FIs are investing or DIs are selling or DIs are buying or FIs are investing a certain point of time. So that stock pops up, buying opportunity or a selling opportunity, whatever. So it goes in this. Now artificial intelligence has again come into the technical analysis study. So these situations are now the, every day, every second day technology is changing. Every second there will be a new invention in the technology and will have to be implemented in these kind of theories also. So technical, as a beginner, I don't think technical analysis or this thing, one should get into these type of things. You should have a proper advisor or this thing that would help. As far as fundamentals are concerned, fundamentals are basically based on all the factors. I would say not on the balance sheet, but on the business. See, today a company's balance sheet might not be that strong, but business might be very, very strong. We all know this is the history. When you start the business, it takes approximately 5 years, 10 years, 15 years to build an Infosys. Today, it took approximately 35 years. 35 years are there. So at that time, once who had studied the business of Infosys or had a long-term vision, I know one of my clients, he was when there was an IPO, they were holding 20% of the shares of the Infosys. Today, that company is bankrupt. It's a different case altogether. It was my father's one of the biggest clients in those times. But Infosys is somewhere else. Even if today that company might have holded those shares of Infosys, the company's value might would have been much more than the Infosys value as of today. So to study the fundamental analysis, it is very, very important to study the business of the company and the business morale of the company and the corporate governance of the company. These two things are important for having the fundamentals of the company. After that, of course, yes, the balance sheet tells you all the rest of the story, and based on the figures available publicly on the public domain and published in the annual report or balance sheets quarterly, annually, or whenever, you can have the fundamental research of that company. But before that, my advice would be to have a deep study or in-depth study of the fundamental business of the company. But as a beginner, my view would be, for a beginner, both these won't help unless and until you have a good advisor who is advising you or who is backing you. Because the advisor studies both these things and he takes advice of many other people in this industry who are much more expert than him also. There are many people who take advice from me, and there are many n number of people who take advice from whom I take the advice. So it is both ways. One cannot be expert in both. One can never be expert in fundamental analysis or technical analysis. You have to study, and this is an ongoing process. Researches are also there. And now, as I said in my previous also, technology has been so vast that it's changing every second. So both these factors drive the fundamental and technical studies and technical analysis also.
Okay, sir. And can you also explain us what are margin requirements for investing and trading, and also what are margin norms?
See, in today's scenario, the margin requirements have changed drastically. Approximately now, today 100% margin is required if you are trading in equities, and say approximately 50% to 75% margin requirements are there if you are trading in futures segment or in commodity segment. Today the margin norms have been changed by SEBI. For the past 1 year, the SEBI is implementing the margin. Previously it was 25%. Now after 3 months or 4 months, it was 50%. Now it is 75%. That is approximately 100%. So today one needs to understand that suppose if any broker or any stock broker or any online platforms are giving you 10 times, 5 times, 6 times margin on your trade, on margin for you to trade or invest, one thing is there. You should first have the complete knowledge of the margin requirements and what do you want to do? Do you want to invest or trade? So as depending upon that, keep your trading and investments intact. Today, margins are approximately 100%. Suppose if you require, if you want to buy 10,000 rupees, if you want to invest 10,000 rupees in the market, it is very important that you should first pay 10,000 rupees to your stockbroker or with whom you trade. Approximately 75% and 100% is nothing. It's almost the same. So as a broker, to safeguard my risk or to have the interest of the client, I take 100% margins upfront. So margin requirements are there. It has been they are now one-to-one reported by the stockbroker to the exchanges. One-to-one margin is being reported. Exchange collect the reports. And if the margin is not being paid properly by the client to the stockbroker as per the setup by the SEBI, there is a penalty debited to the client's account. This is never known to the client. Many of the investors or traders are not aware of this thing, that if your margin, there is a shortfall in your margin, exchanges ask for your margin requirement from the stockbroker at least 3 times or 4 times in a day, whenever it is up to them. So if a broker, a stockbroker or an online platform is giving you 5 times, 7 times, 10 times margin, be sure that there will be a penalty debited to your account. And in the day end, you'll have to scare off your additional trades. Might be in profit or losses, that's a different thing, but penalty will be debited to your ledger account. Am I right, Anish, if you want to add something?
Yes, sir, as I've been on the receiving end. So I would like that the penalties are very, very heavy. And if you are doing derivatives compared to the target profit you are envisaging, the penalty would be definitely very high compared to that. So rather, I would say don't utilize the margin if you are somewhere on the corner of your margin requirement. Rather, always keep around 15% of the total earning margin as a free usable margin, because overnight also margin changes. So
it's up to the exchange. Suppose today exchange is advised us to collect, say, 50%. Overnight, they'll change the circular in the midnight itself. It's up to them. From tomorrow, immediately there are 75% requirements. From today, there might be 80% requirements. They might reduce it also. It's up to the exchanges. So please be very careful whenever you are investing or whenever you are trading about the margin requirements. Don't get fascinated towards the heavy margin trading facility given by the brokers or online platforms. Very sure penalty will be debited by the exchange. It is everything online. You are a client directly of the exchange through an intermediary. Your account codes are different. Your DMAT account codes are different. Everything is different. And it is everything online. It's absolutely artificial intelligence and complete use of a technological mechanism. Is there no manual intervention, no manual entry, nothing. Penalties will be debited and penalties are very heavy. You just can't imagine what your penalties are. Might be up to, suppose if you give a margin of 20,000 and if you trade for 5 lakhs, penalty would be round about in the range of, say, 20,000 to 50,000. And your profit might be hardly rupees 500 or so. So you'll be end up paying heavy penalties and heavy losses.
Okay, sir. I guess we will keep that in mind now. Also, many of us are unaware about the NISM exams. Abhijit, sir, can you please guide us on that?
See, NISM is National Securities Management training course. If you want to pursue, if one wants to pursue a career in the financial markets or capital markets, might be in any field, even in banking field also, there are various examinations conducted by the NISM. There are various modules. They are having online courses for that also. Online courses are there. Previously, they were having offline courses. Now, everything is today online. So there are n number of modules, currency module for capital markets, derivatives module, equity module, DP exams have to be cleared. Then mutual fund advisory are there, insurance advisory modules are there, banking is there. So once, if you want to pursue a career in the financial markets or in the capital markets, you have to clear or you have to pass out these examinations. Unless and until you don't get the certificate from these, the passing certificate from these various examinations, you won't be able to pursue your career legally in this field. And once you start up your office or whatever, you have to place all these certificates on your office in the office premises with your photographs and everything, so that there is a SEBI conducts your audits of the office premises also. So it might be a surprise audit by the SEBI also. Might be surprise audit by the SEBI or might be surprise audit by your member broker with whom you are associated. So you have to keep all these examination certificate pasted in your office in a visible area wherever you want to have. So this is basically what NISM is.
Thank you, sir. आजकल social media platforms पे बहुत सारे लोग ये ज्ञान देते कि if you invest a particular amount at 15% or 20% CAGR, you will have crores in your bank account by the age of 50. Anish sir, can we actually achieve this target? And if we want to, what is the practical approach?
See, mathematically, the calculations are bang on. Sir had also taken the example in his previous answer. But see, the real Herculean task in this, I agree that sir would also agree with this, that getting 20 consistently for 30 to 40 years is a very, very hard task. See, for last few years, we have been in a bull market. So for newbies or new investors, they would think that 20 to kya, main ek mahine mein kama lunga ya ek hafte mein kama lunga. So see, consistently you're getting 20% for 30 to 40 years is like God mode only. So that is very, very great thing to achieve. So basically, aapko waise businesses chahiye who can compound at 20% per annum and stay put in them. So as to how to achieve is, that is very subjective. So main thing is finding such business and getting compounded at that rate. So it is achievable. But then you have to have the requisite knowledge, you have to have the requisite experience, and all of those above things that matter in getting such a high return. So all are there. Yes.
So does it involve frequent buying and selling? For example, if I am getting 20% return on a particular share, should I sell and realize the profit to reinvest it, or should I wait for years to share to achieve its new heights?
So taking the first point of buying and selling, see, there are many instruments in the market. So buying and selling is generally, you must be referring just to equity shares. So other than equity shares, there are futures, there are options, there are currency, there are commodities. So I know futures and options, commodities are a bit risky. But the thing is, you have to be subjective. Some may be good in futures, some may be good in options. So I recommend you study all of the above, find your niche and run with it. So whichever instrument you are comfortable with, you go and go for it. Secondly, the thing is that you are getting 20% return. So whether to hold or whether to sell it. So this all again comes down to the system which you have evolved. See, every trader should have a system. So what is system? So system will basically tell you as to why you have bought that stock. So why you have bought, that is equal to basically the analysis which you have done, which led you to this decision. The second thing is to when to buy. So the system you are following will also tell you at what point you should enter. And the third and the most crucial thing in today's market is the exit, which is often overlooked. The thing is, exit should not be defined at some future time. It should be defined right at the moment when you're taking the trade. So if you're an intraday trader, the exit should be intraday such. If you're a short-term trader, if you're a long-term trader, so the time frame should be such that you have to exit between that. And at latter point, let's say you can, of course, use trailing stop loss or some other mechanism to control the profit. But the thing is, DMAT account or the broker's trading account should only be opened at the time of execution. All the strategy, all the planning should be done beforehand. So app is just for execution. App won't tell you when to enter, when to exit. That should be the basis of your own analysis. So this is the basic lacking factor. And coming to that, if the share is 20% up and it is, should I buy or sell? So I follow technical analysis religiously. So the cardinal rule of technical analysis is always buy strength and sell weakness. So I will let the stock continue running up if I see that there is still momentum, there is good volume, and there is still potential. I will even buy more if I see that there is still potential in this. So after, if my analysis tells me that no, the momentum is now getting over, or now it has been in overbought territory, or it is very overvalued, at that time I may cut my losses. So I cut my losses or I book my profits. So it is whole system driven. So discretionary trading should be taken out of the whatever trading you are following. Yes.
One thing I would like to add in this, if you don't mind. See, Anish has rightly said that he would buy or after 20%. See, if there is a momentum or if there is a good strength and you have bought and you're getting 20% return, there is a mechanism that you can keep stop losses in your profits also. So if you're getting 20% and if you see a good potential in the company or in the stock, so you can keep the stop loss of your trade or on your investment, say, at around 15 or 16%. So that this some uncertainty is there. If the stock comes down, your trade automatically gets scared off or your positions are automatically cut, and you at least end up 15 to 16%. If it again rises up, you can increase your stop losses in your profits.
You can always roll up
in the profits. So yes, it's a very higher chance that you might get 23, 22, 25 or even more than that returns if you keep stop losses in the profitable trade, in the profit this thing. Suppose if you have invested 100 and you're getting 120, keep a stop loss of 115 or 116. If it goes to 125, increase your stop loss to 120. As and when the price of the share increases, increase your stop loss. So the chances of getting your returns are much higher.
Exactly. Well, thank you, sir. Nowadays, people are attracted to a word called multibagger, thinking that stock with low prices, that is penny stocks, are undervalued and has huge potential. They are ready to invest their hard-earned money in any penny stock without any knowledge. Abhijit, sir, what would you suggest such people?
See, I would suggest such people as... if they are investing in such kind of stocks, they should invest that their money will be lost completely if they invest in penny stocks or unknown stocks or without having the proper knowledge of the stock or without gaining the proper knowledge of the stock from an expert. See, investing in a penny stock is a very, very risky thing, and people take such risk because suppose if I advise any of my client to buy an Infosys or a Bajaj Finance or say a good companies, you'd say, yaar, kya aega usme? 10 share aayenge, 20 share aayenge, 1 lakh rupaye mein kya 100 share aayenge? If I advise them to invest Bajaj Finance, they'd say, kya yaar, 10-20 share aayenge, isme to kya hai? Apan will buy Suzlon, 1 lakh share aayega, 1 rupaye upar gaya to bhi 1 lakh kamenge. Lekin wo pura loss hone ki bhi risk utni hi hai. So if you, there's no, to find a multi-bagger stock, it's a once in a lifetime opportunity. Everybody cannot find a multi-bagger stock. See, suppose the live example is Bajaj Finance. I have personally myself experienced it. That's why I'm sharing you with this. Suppose if I had invested, on my birthday in 2008 or 9, I don't remember, 1 lakh rupees in Bajaj Finance. Till today, if I would have kept it, you just can't imagine after all these ups and downs, the value of Bajaj Finance, what it would have been today. But I exited at around, say, approximately in a span of 6 to 7 months, three and a half times, because I was at that time I was very much satisfied, and in those times there were such technologies and all the available and this information was not available on the net across the board. Today such kind of technological changes have been done. This is a long back story, 2007 or 2008. Suppose if I would have kept it till today, my 1 lakh investment value would have been approximately around 6.5 crores. And if I would have done plus and minuses in that only, then it would have been around much more than that. But it's a long-term story. If anybody might have invested 10,000 or say 1 lakh in Infosys, it would have been 13, 15 crores. These things are history. But to find such stocks is a very difficult thing. To find a stock like Suzlon penny stock, it's a very, very easy thing. And to find such kind of penny stocks, say a penny stock such as Bajaj Finance or a penny stock like Adani Enterprises or whatever, it's a very, very difficult thing. And might mind it, there is nobody, as far as I know, I don't know about Anish, there is nobody or a trader or an investor who gets 3.5 times return in a span of, say, 5 months, 6 months or 7 months, he won't exit his positions. It is very true he'll exit his positions. This was a story long back, say, 13, 14 years back. If I would have sold at Bajaj Finance, I would have kept in FD, earned approximately 35-40 lakhs of interest per annum, nothing else, nothing need to be done for the lifetime. So, but it's a very difficult thing to find such a penny stock. Even I would have today also, if anybody finds such a stock, it would be a great thing. But to find a penny stock, it's a very difficult thing. Who would be a multi-bagger? This never happens. Once if you're investing in a penny stock, be ready that your investments would be washed up completely and nothing will come in your hand. That is very sure. As far as my experience is there in the markets of say 20, 21 years, I've never seen a multi-bagger stock, a penny stock becoming a multi-bagger stock. This never happens. It is just Gyanchan and Raichan on the social media platforms. And nobody knows these Gyanchan and Raichan people on the social media platforms. Even many people ask me, humne YouTube pe video dekha, kal market bahut crash hone wala hai. One of my client had texted me at around 11:30 PM in the night, 2-3 days before. Sir, humne so YouTube pe bhi video dekha, 2 or 3 June ka ya 3 or 4 June ka market bahut crash hone wala hai. Maine bola, bhai, tu hi dekh, tu hi decide kar, I don't know. अगर ये सब इतना मुझे पता होता तो मैं खुद ही 10-10 करोड़ रुपए लगा के करता, बिजनेस करता ही नहीं. सो इट नेवर हैपेंस दैट अ पेनी स्टॉक बिकम्स अ मल्टीबैगर.
सर अभी आपने ये जो एग्जांपल बताया, आपको रिग्रेट होता है क्या? और अगर होता है तो आप कैसे डील करते हो?
नहीं होता उस वक्त में, कभी नहीं होगा. पैसा गंवाने से तो अच्छा, आप 3 times अगर पैसा मिल रहा है 6 महीने में, किसको मिलता है? इट वॉज अ मल्टीबैगर फॉर मी इन जस्ट 6 months.
अगर आप रिग्रेट करना लगोगे तो हर एक शेयर पे आपको रिग्रेट करना पड़ेगा कि अरे आज ये ऊपर
बेचा
था. ट्रेडिंग हैज टू बी इमोशनलेस. यू कैनॉट सी, देयर इज अ सेइंग, व्हेन अ गुड ट्रेडर मेक्स प्रॉफिट ही गेट्स वेरी हैप्पी, व्हेन अ ग्रेट ट्रेडर मेक्स अ ह्यूज प्रॉफिट ही इज ओके, ही इज नॉट एट ऑल इमोशनल. सो बेसिकली it's okay, it's fine with it. So basically you have to cut down your emotions totally from your trading.
Usko paisa bhi ho sakta tha ki maine aaj agar
gir bhi gaya rehta
tha, charo girta tha to kya karte the? Aaj jo mil raha wo apna
sahi hai,
that is the thing.
और सर आपने मेंशन किया कि आपने बर्थडे पे स्टॉक लिया था, तो आपके ऐसा ट्रेडिशन है कि आप हर बर्थडे पे लेते हो?
नहीं, मुझे वो स्टॉक उस वक्त बहुत अच्छा लगा था, बिकॉज़ आई एम इनटू द फाइनेंशियल बिजनेस. I handle the loan proposals for my clients also. I like the business of that company at that time. So I had done one proposal as a DSA and I earned a lakh rupees from that. I Bajaj Finance lakh rupees ka mera, apne Bajaj Finance ne apne ko lakh rupees diya, apne uska share kare to. That was my thinking at that time. No study, nothing. I just like the business idea of Bajaj Finance. That's it. I didn't study it at that time. I told you there, at that time, no such, there were not many opportunities to study the businesses or to have the analysis of the balance sheet or to gain knowledge from. Today, every second, as I told you, technologies are changing. At that time, nobody used to have internet. At that time, we were used to operate on VSAT. The cost to run our firm, to run my business, was 20,000 per month. The brokerage was hardly 50,000 per month. The cost to run the business for the VSAT was 20,000 rupees per month, plus additional cost. At that time, I was not earning, it was approximately nil. No loss, no profit business for 7-8 years. And everything was happening in those times. Ketan Parikh scam, then Akshardham, then September 11 attacks, then Osama bin Laden, then Modi, Atal Bihari Vajpayee to Manmohan Singh. This was the scenario at that time. So every day scenario changes and you have to be happy with what you have got. That's the rule of the market. Once you buy, stock will come. Once you sell, stock will go up. If these things are not there, you only buy and you only will sell. That's it. So I don't regret. I don't regret. Never.
Right, sir. So depending upon our risk appetite, what should an ideal portfolio look like? Like how to divide capital in debt and equity? Also, if we go in details, how to subdivide it in large cap and small cap funds? Anish, sir?
Yeah. So let me make a few assumptions. As this question is subjective, so I will make a few assumptions. So first, I will make an assumption that all the viewers are say students in the age of, let's say, 18 to 25. Second, you don't have any liabilities. And third, that you don't require any money in the near term. So if all these above conditions are valid, then I would suggest all of you to invest 100% in equities. Large cap, mid cap and small cap may depend upon your risk appetite. See, if we look at developing countries like US, like Japan, in US, the interest rates are around 0.1%, 0.3%. In Japan, there is also a concept of negative interest rate. Well, bank takes money from you for holding your money. So if we assume that going forward, India will also be a developed economy, we can be sure that interest rate will go even further down. So right now, if you have seen the over last 2 or 3 years, all the interest rates have come down drastically. So basically, the return of debt funds is directly tied with the interest rates of their economy. So believing that India is going to be amongst the developed economies, interest rates are going to go down for sure. On the other hand, as per the latest report, inflation of consumer inflation index is about 6% in India. So if you go at high level debt funds like money market funds, liquid funds, they give you around 4 to 5% return. So you're not even making over and above inflation. So I took few assumptions that you don't have any liability and you don't require money in the near term. So if out of these two, any of the assumption is not held to be true, that is you have certain liabilities which you have to pay off and you require certain money in near term, then that much money can of course be kept in debt fund. But looking at your age and looking at the years ahead of you, you have for getting a great, great compounding return, I suggest you to invest 100% in equity. Because apart from equity, the investing in interest is like basically you're losing money due to inflation each year. And about like of the asset mix I told. So instead of let's get going plainly for just large cap, mid cap and small cap, I suggest you can go into multi cap. There are also certain mutual funds like balanced fund or some like volatility fund, which when the markets are overvalued, they go into debt. And when the markets are on low valuation, they sell their debts and come again in equity. So basically, the crux is that you should go 100% into equity.
Anish has rightly said, and what I would like to add is in this early age of your career and this thing, as you don't have any liabilities or for say at least 5 or 6 years, there won't be any other things behind you, such as say marriage and then kids and everything. So it is whatever you're earning and you don't have any liabilities, you can, it is very good to have investment, active investment in equities, and say around the next 3 to 5 years, equity markets would be booming. Ups and downs will be there. Just don't get afraid of these things. There, fear, greed and fear will always be there in the markets. But one should hold on to his investments and you would be getting very, very good returns if you start investing from today itself. Even if you start from say 2,000, 3,500, 5,000 rupees a month, that your payouts would be very, very higher say after 3 to 5 years down the line, as the scenarios and the money is pumping in the stock markets.
Okay, thank you for the guidance. But nowadays there is less guidance and more misguidance on social media about stock market. Abhijit sir, what would you think about social media affecting our finances?
Your social media affecting your finances. See, if you get access to the social media or if you get advice from the social media for your finances, then the people guiding you would be in a position to finance you for your financial needs. That is, all your funds would be lost. That is very, very sure. That is very, very sure. Because you don't know the person with whom you're interacting on the social media. Do you tell me, do you know the person with whom you're interacting?
No.
Or do you know what he is into?
No.
Suppose tomorrow if I start a Telegram channel or a Twitter account or a Facebook account, share trade, multi-bagger share trade, share profit, out trade karo paisa kamao. It's very easy to just get 10,000 people. There are the population of the country is 130 crores. It's very easy to have 10,000 people giving me 2,000 rupees per month. No, it's not a very, very tough job. It's a very easy job. There is no this thing. You don't have to market yourself to go to roam around the city or market yourself with just online marketing. Sit at your place in a AC cabin or in a AC bedroom and just market yourself online. It is very easy to get 10,000 people, 10,000 people in a span of say 6 months or 1 year and to get 2,000 or 3,000 rupees per month from them. But do you really know the person with whom you are dealing with? So you would end up wiping out all your finances and your savings, because they are totally gyanchan and raichan on the social media platforms. They are nothing else. And suppose if you deal with the advisor, he would charge you. But when you pay something, you have whenever you buy something for a money, you have that good advice and you get the proper knowledge. He will explain you the all the things for that investment. Why is he asking you to invest in such kind of investment or in such kind of stocks, or might be whatever, might be in various asset classes, might be in property, stock markets, mutual funds, debt funds, anywhere. But you will get his guidance, and then and only then you will be able to know okay, whether, and then and only then you will decide okay, whether I should invest or not. Simple thing. If you want to buy a 10,000 rupees mobile, do you buy it just like that, or you just you get complete update of that mobile? Kitne GB RAM hai, kitna kaam karega, game khelenge.
Yes.
Correct. Or even if you go to buy your clothes, first you take the trial of that of your clothes. Barabar fitting ho raha hai ya nahi ho raha hai ya kya ho raha hai ya aise hi khareed lete de diya le liya. Gift aaya baat alag hai. लेकिन जब खुद खरीदते हैं तब क्या करते हैं, बराबर है? कोई भी एनीथिंग वी व्हेन वी व्हेन व्हेन वी बाय वी जस्ट एनालाइज और टेक द कंप्लीट नॉलेज ऑफ दैट थिंग. करेक्ट. टेक द एडवाइस ऑफ दैट थिंग. सो विदाउट हैविंग प्रॉपर नॉलेज और प्रॉपर गाइडेंस और विदाउट हैविंग द प्रॉपर इंटरेक्शन विद द पर्सन विद हुम यू आर डीलिंग विद ऑन द सोशल मीडिया, इज इट करेक्ट टू टेक गाइडेंस फ्रॉम देम? So just forget this social media platforms for these type of investing. They are purely gyanchan and raichan. Ha, it's a different thing altogether. In this pandemic the scenario, many good technical analysts and fundamental analysts have started online platforms. It's a different case altogether. But I think you might be understanding the difference of whom I am talking.
Yes, yes, yes.
Suppose if there are many learned people also have started their online courses and online platform and online advisory services, it's a different thing altogether. They are there in the market, they're reputed people, but these kind of keep aloof yourself from these kind of people.
I will just like to add one more thing. So if you have seen, whenever these people tweet online, they always end whatever they want to sell with for educational purposes only. So even if you get wiped out, they can always say that, okay, we are not answerable to you because we had already given a disclaimer that it is for educational purpose only. So when you go through an authorized advisor, at least he is answerable to some extent to you.
At least he would be in a position to guide you that curtail your losses.
Yes.
See, everybody might go wrong. They have the right to go wrong.
Of course.
They have the right to go wrong. Everybody, every time, nobody will be correct. But
yes,
they would be in a position to advise you to curtail your law losses.
Thank you for such peaceful advice. Anish sir, nowadays newbies expect instant results from stock market, same as Raju did from Lakshmi Chit Fund. Ye to 25 din mein paisa double wali scheme hai. What would you suggest people who invest upon such Telegram channels suggestions and their friend suggestions?
See, trading is a game of probability and not certainty. So when you do, let's assume, fundamental analysis or some technical analysis, to certain degree, you get a certain amount of probability. In trading, of the entire inputs like buying, selling, profit, loss, one of the component which is totally in your control is the probability and the hard work you put behind getting that certainty. So, jaisa aapka attitude hoga, waisa aapka return hoga. If you go in, if you study the stock, if you analyze the stock, you get certain degree of probability, which would be multiplied by the success rate. सो हायर द प्रोबेबिलिटी हायर वुड बी द सक्सेस रेट. सो अगर आप मार्केट में इस सेंस से एंटर कर रहे हो कि ठीक है आज मैं 200,000 रुपए दे रहा हूँ, कल के कल या एक दो हफ्ते में मुझको आप 400,000 वापस दे दो, तो ऐसा नहीं होगा. ट्रीट इट लाइक अ बिजनेस. वुड यू रिस्क योर एंटायर कैपिटल ऑन वन आर टू टिप्स गिवन बाय समबडी? ऑफ कोर्स नॉट. सो जैसा आपका एटीट्यूड होगा वैसा आपका रिटर्न होगा. अगर आपका एटीट्यूड गैम्बलिंग का है तो आपको रिटर्न भी गैम्बलिंग की तरह मिलेंगे. भले ही एक दो या भले ही तीन बार आपका कैपिटल डबल हो जाएगा, पर फॉर फोर्थ टाइम श्योरली यू विल गेट वाइप्ड आउट. एज यू नो द रूल, द हाउस ऑलवेज विंस. सो एट द एंड द कैसीनो विल ऑलवेज विन. एंड अदर देन दैट, वन क्वेश्चन विच वी गेट आस्क अ लॉट इज, मैं इतना कैपिटल दे रहा हूँ तो मेरा रिटर्न कितना होगा? तो अरे एक्चुअली स्टॉक मार्केट में ऐसा चीज नहीं कि मैंने इतना लगाया तो मुझको इतना चाहिए. इट ऑल डिपेंड्स ऑन द हार्ड वर्क यू पुट इन. इट ऑल डिपेंड्स ऑन द मार्केट विच यू आर इन. सो ऑफकोर्स अगर आप एनालिसिस करोगे, अगर आप स्टडी करोगे, हार्डवर्क करोगे, तो ही रिटर्न आना बाकी है. अगर गैम्बलिंग करके आपको जस्ट पैसे लगा के कुछ चाहिए, तो यू आर बेटर, वी आर गेटिंग एटलीस्ट बेटर ऑड्स देन गैम्बलिंग, वेर यू आर एटलीस्ट प्रॉमिस 200 to 500%. सो दैट इज अ बेटर एवेन्यू फॉर यू. सो एवरीथिंग कम्स डाउन ऑन योर एटीट्यूड.
राइट सर, आपने जब जो अभी बोला वो हमने अभी इलॉन मस्क के ट्वीट्स वगैरह में भी देखा था. एंड फ्यू डेज अगो कंपनी नेम बॉम्बे ऑक्सीजन कॉर्पोरेशन लिमिटेड, एक्चुअली NBFC, mistakenly assumed as oxygen suppliers, shoot up to almost 250%. This shows that how much people are unaware about the investments. So Anisa, what are your views on it?
So I'll just give a basic background to this. So 2 months back in Maharashtra, there was acute, not just in Maharashtra and in entire India, there was acute shortage of oxygen. So people are mainly the retail customer, the retail investors had started lapping up any share with the name oxygen, gas or etc. like this in their name. So I will just take an example. So see, of course, the normal answer to this question would be, okay, aap sab dekho, phir invest karo. But I will just give me a leeway of taking a different route or taking a different example. And so I'll just give a bias would be towards the technical side in the example I'm taking. So basically there are 3 types of investors in the market. One is the fundamental investor. Second is a technical investor who follow technicals. And the third investor is the one who follows God. So the fundamental trader. So basically in fundamental, they see whether the stock is overvalued or undervalued. If the stock is undervalued, they buy. If the stock is overvalued, they sell. So a fundamental investor while looking at the charts of Bombay Oxygen and looking at the data available, he would have seen that, okay, the P/E ratio is very overvalued and business is also okay, only investment. So it should actually trade at discount of the investment and not at higher valuation. So he would have avoided investing in it. Secondly, the one who follows God, he would have seen that, are ye bhi buy kar raha hai, wo bhi buy kar raha hai. अरे कंटिन्यूअस सर्किट लग रहे हैं, आज 10% ऊपर, कल 20% ऊपर, तो चलो चलो डाल दो पैसे इसमें. सो ही वुड हैव इन्वेस्टेड इन दैट. एंड द थर्ड वुड बी द टेक्निकल ट्रेडर. सो दिस पार्ट वुड कैन बी अ बिट टेक्निकल, सो यू जस्ट टेल मी इफ यू डोंट अंडरस्टैंड एनी एस्पेक्ट ऑफ इट. सो आई हैव लुक्ड एट द चार्ट ऑफ बॉम्बे ऑक्सीजन. सो बेसिकली फॉर अ ईयर अराउंड इट वॉज ट्रेडिंग बिटवीन 9,000 to 11,500. एंड एट अप्रैल और एट सम ऑफ दैट पॉइंट it crossed 11,500 and even it breached 12,000. So at that point, a technical investor would have got a pop-up, or he would have screened in the screener or whatever he used, he would have seen that this stock has broken above its 1 year average and it has also gone above its 2 years resistance. So at that point, the signal would be of buy. And at that point, there were heavy volumes. So signal being buy and also heavy volumes would have confirmed his trade. So a technical trader would have entered at around a level of 12,000. However, the technical trader, as a technical trader I told you, he has to have a defined entry and he has to have a defined exit. So when the stock had reached 18,000 and even at 22,000, the RSI, which is the which gives whether the stock is overbought or oversold, would have given him a signal that RSI being above 95, it is definitely time to leave from the market. So he would have gotten at around 12,000 odd and I would have got at around 18,000 to 22,000 odd price. So he would have made a cool 50%. So he would have been able to exit as well. However, the one who follows God, his share would have gone up to 25,000. However, having no defined entry and having no defined exit, he would have now been stuck in the stock. As for, I guess, for last month, the stock is continuously hitting its circuit and there is no chance to exit. So basically, there are three types of traders. So, yeah.
Anish sir, is there any possibility that GameStop incident can happen in India?
I'll just give a background before going about, before starting this. So the stock price of this video retail company, I guess, was trading about some $20 in January. And it shot up to staggering $350 in a matter of few days. So what is more interesting is that behind the surge weren't any hedge funds or FIIs or any big investors. Actually, it was a group of retailers on Reddit known as Wall Street Bets. The thing is, they came together to prop up this stock against, as they had got information that certain hedge funds were holding short position in this stock. So basically, what is short position? In short position, you sell first and then buy later. For example, let's assume a share is trading at 1,000 rupees and you have a conviction that in like few days, the stock will come down to, let's say, 800 rupees. So logically, to make profit, you will have to sell first at 1,000 rupees and then cover your position, or you have to buy again at, let's say, 800, making a cool 200% profit. However, there was a great short squeeze in the bet of AMC. So what basically happened was, the hedge funds were short on this. So they had sold a stock expecting to buy at a lower valuation. But due to this Wall Street bets, the share had shot up from, let's say, $20 to almost $300. So actually, of course, the hedge funds would have averaged it out and the mathematics wouldn't be the same for hedge fund. I'll just give you a pure example. So let's assume they had bought the stock at $20. They had, sold the stock at $20. So now they have to again buy at 300. So you have sold something at 20 and now you have to buy at 300. So around 180%, 180 rupees loss. So due to which many of the hedge funds even went bankrupt. So now coming to India, is it possible in India? So see, the regulations of US are a little different and the regulations of India are different. So in US, all the shares are held by the broker and have been kept in their pool account. So the ownership is with the broker. However, the beneficial owner is the trader who has bought the stock. In India, the custody of the share is kept with NSDL and CDSL. So the broker just accesses it and the actual custody is with them. So the brokers are not able to freely lend securities. In India, there is also a mechanism known as SLBM, that is stock lending and borrowing mechanism. It is regulated. But the thing is, the stocks offered in that are very low, about few hundred. So not all stocks are available, because the thing is that liquidity should be there before offering that stock. And secondly, the liquidity is also very poor, as it is not that popular. And thirdly, there are certain things like circuits in the market. So basically, if there is an either movement of, let's say, 10%, 15%, or like in Bombay, we are seeing a lower circuit. So due to circuits, many of the trades won't be possible in India. Other than that, the most important point is that there is a regulation known as market-wide position limit in India. So what this regulation is that you are not allowed to take a position in, let's say, derivatives or cash segment or even SLBM over and about 20% of free float. So if the market cap is, let's say, about 1 lakh rupees, at the most you can take the positions or you can go short for is 20,000. So over there is a limit of how much short you can build up. In AMC's case, the short built up due to leverage was so high that it had gone even above 100%. So if I can remember properly, I've read somewhere that the short position built up was 137%. So mathematically, it is very difficult to happen. So in India, it is not possible due to that.
Okay. Abhijit sir, we have thousands of times heard this sentence that mutual fund investment are subject to market risk. But what are some factors one should consider before investing in mutual fund to minimize their risk?
See, mutual fund investment are subject to market risks is a very common, it's a disclaimer given by all the mutual fund companies before you invest in the mutual fund. Basically, mutual fund also by taking small amounts of money from the retail individuals or financial institutions or even the big investments, they invest directly in the stock markets and some portion of that in the debts. So the basic idea behind is that suppose if tomorrow the market crashes, as it happened last year also, previously it has happened many times. So that's why they are giving the disclaimer as mutual fund investments are subject to market risk as and when the market or crashes due to n number of factors, say global factors or political changes in the country or due to factors like now in the current scenario like COVID or any other factor previously it has happened. So this is the basic the reason. That's why they give you they give the investors this disclaimer as mutual fund investments are subject to market risk. That is the only reason. Now coming to your second question, what this one should take care in mutual funds before investing. See basically when you select a specific scheme of any mutual fund scheme, there are n number of schemes with n number of mutual fund companies. Nobody can pick up the scheme which is giving consistently say 18%, 20%, 30% return down the year. One scheme may give 30% in 1 year, as it has happened previously. In the last last financial year, only one scheme gave the return, that is some Axis, or I don't remember, the Axis long term equity fund or something like that. They gave a return of say around 18-19% or 20%. Rest all the schemes were with negative returns. So it is not possible that you select a proper scheme to invest in a mutual fund. The only thing is key, you get the before investing, you can get the knowledge of the scheme, in which stocks that scheme is going to invest and how much portion they are going to invest in equities and how much portion they are going to invest in the debts. It depends on the type of the fund you select. But since you are in an early age of your career, it is very necessary to have or say it is if anyone asks me, I would suggest everybody that you should invest in such kind of schemes who are investing directly in equities. As you had asked previously to question to me as how fundamental and technical analysis are really important. So I said at an early start of career, if you want to have a career in the stock markets, then and only then you should have a research of that. And if you are not pursuing a career in the financial field or a banking field or financial field in the capital markets or so, that's why the option of mutual fund is there. And the investment in directly equities through good financial advisors should always be kept open. So you can have the idea or the knowledge of that specified scheme in which stocks they're investing and have an idea of those stocks in what percentage they're investing. I think the norm is approximately one scheme cannot invest more than 10% of their total investment in a certain stock. They have given the proposals, all the companies, all the AMCs have given the proposal to SEBI to increase this limit. That's why they need to shift their investment. If the investment criteria crosses 10%, they need to sell and invest in other stocks. So that's the only reason why it is that mutual fund is subject to market risk.
I'll just like to add one more point. There is a new regulation now that the fund manager has also need to invest 20% of his salary in the fund. So this would greatly increase the accountability of him, as well as the nature of risk would, I guess, gradually reduce to match his accountability. So that is, from our point of view, of course, that is a very good suggestion. Good. From fund manager's point of view, it is really bad for him. Yeah.
Sir, currently some words such as Bitcoin, cryptocurrency are trending. People see some videos and memes about it and assume that they know everything and start investing their hard-earned money without any research and without understanding the technology behind it. Anish sir, what would you advise such people? Do you personally believe in cryptocurrency? Do you think it will change the face of currency as we deal in it?
I'll just give some background before I begin. See, in the US, Bitcoin is treated as a commodity and taxed as such. So it is legal in the US. In Japan, also it is treated as a property. So that's again legal in Japan as well. In European Union, it is treated as a qualified financial instrument. Thus, it is also legal in Europe. So when such mother markets and such super developed economies consider something to be legal, in some or the other form, then I don't think like countries like India can stay far behind and ban it. And see, we have seen the magnificent returns given by all the cryptocurrencies in the previous year. So of course there is something to it, because if you see, the market cap is also in trillions. So something like having a market cap in trillions can rarely vanish in thin air. Of course, cryptocurrency may, but I don't think that it will. Apart from cryptocurrency, wealth has also been made in exchanges. If you have read the news, you must have heard about Coinbase, the big cryptocurrency exchange in the US, which got listed. I'll just tell you what valuation it got listed. In 2018, it was valued at somewhere around $8 billion. But when it got listed about 1 or 2 months back, it got listed at $100 billion. So it is almost 1,000% in less than 3 years. So it is very, very staggering numbers. In India, in 2018, RBI had banned not the cryptocurrency, but had banned the banks from providing any support to crypto exchanges. So when you cut banks from any environment, there are no inflows of cash. So basically, cryptocurrency was banned from 2018. However, last year, the Supreme Court has reversed the circular issued by RBI. The thing is, what the Supreme Court has quoted that RBI was not able to show any significant damage which has been caused by these crypto exchanges. So the ruling of Supreme Court is not on the legality of Bitcoin, but rather that the circular issued that banks cannot give any support to crypto exchanges, that is quashed. So till now, there is no legal backing to Bitcoin. However, there are several news articles circulating that some committee has been formed or some regulations may be soon in place in India. So I'm hoping that Bitcoin can be legalized in India as well. However, I am in no notion that India, that Bitcoin or any cryptocurrency can come and be used as a currency. I believe that it would be legalized, but it would be legalized as some or the other form of financial instrument and not as a currency. See, currency being a souvenir right of the central bank, I don't think that they will ever hand it over to somebody or even some decentralized organization. So it would come, but it would come as an asset rather than as a currency or medium of exchange. So that is that. And the thing about investing is, see, I don't think it as an investment or as a serious investment at this point. If tweets of some person like Elon Musk can like shake something, can take something up 100% and again can bring it back to the same level, then how can we say that this is decentralized and can be a currency of future? See, for something to be a currency, it should be steady. And transfer of property or the transfer of item should be something liquid or something steady should be there. So volatility of such high amount cannot be a currency. And secondly, they say it is decentralized. But if you can see that a person can manipulate something like this, then I don't think it is like there. So until and unless the cryptocurrency gets stable, which I believe that it may happen in some like 5 to 6 years down the line, as some amount of time is required to get some maturity and to have a steady flow. Apart from that, if you say there are n number of cryptocurrency exchanges in India, and out of India there are n number of, so the basic thing is that the price of Bitcoin, if you go and check even online, the prices of Bitcoin are quoted at different values in different exchanges. So there are high chances of arbitrage. So until and unless this can be overcome, I don't think it is a serious investment. But however, I don't mind like investing a few bucks to try my luck in it. So I am fine with investing a few bucks. So it's fine if they get burnt. So that would be a learning or teaching experience for you. Yeah.
Thank you, Anish sir. That was very insightful. Abhijit sir, can you tell us about the career opportunities a CA can pursue in capital markets?
There are a huge lot of career opportunities for a chartered accountant, especially in today's scenario, with an additional qualification of the stock market courses or a CFA after taking the technical and fundamental analysis research. Huge opportunities are there, especially in the research side. All these companies today, all big companies, everybody knows, I don't need to take the names of these companies. They are hiring good learned chartered accountants for their research network. So there are even after gaining experience from working in these companies, one can start his own research financial advisory services. So that is a big booming market in today's scenario. I know quite a few of my colleagues who are chartered accountants in the field, and they have started their research advisory services. They are not in the regular traditional practice or audits or whatever internal audits or say banking, some specialists. They are especially practicing only advisory services. So there is a very vast and huge opportunity. As today, I think only not even 1% of the total population of India are having their demat accounts, or they are investing in the stock markets directly. Many of them are investing indirectly through mutual funds, as they don't have the proper guidance or knowledge of the stock market. So there is a shortage of good advisory consultants in the capital field. So especially on the research and advisory side, there's a very huge potential for a chartered accountant in the capital markets.
Apart from this, there is also a course offered by ICI known as TMBF, that is Diploma in Management and Business Finance. So the faculty for this are reputed faculties from IIM Ahmedabad, Jamnalal Bajaj, Manipal University. So all the top faculties are there for that. So after passing this diploma in financial in management and banking finance, there are also campus placements available with ICI. So though not core trading, I won't say it is a core trading or say core investment type of thing, but also that is covered. And people who come for the recruitment are also mainly from finance industry. So that is also a good course to do.
Abhijit sir, according to you, what will be the booming sectors in near future?
There are a lot of sectors in the near future that will be booming. In today's scenario, if it continues, pharmaceutical sector is a very, very booming sector as of today. Everybody knows, no need to explain that thing. But as far as my this thing concerned, the sector that is going to survive and that is going to boom is the technology services sector. And because as in now, the technology will flourish, it is already flourishing. This concept of work from home is even if this COVID gets over or whatever, now companies are curtailing their costs, their daily expenditures, and I know organizations who have decided that even if whatever their setup is of today, let that setup be as it is, and they'll only work with 25% staff. As everybody knows, TCS has already decided this, and they said they'll be implementing it even if pandemic gets over by 2023, 2024 or 2025, I don't exactly remember. They'd be going with only 25% staff working in their office. So this scenario will be there. What my personal feeling would be that the technology sector will be a booming at all times, as and the financial sector also. It will be a booming sector all the times as far as the retail or retail investors are concerned. There are many other sectors, of course, yes. There will be manufacturing sector, it's a steel, iron ore, all these sectors will change, but the consistent return and everything, a peaceful return would be, you would get from the technology-based companies.
Sir, can you suggest some COVID-free or recession-free stock?
COVID-free or recession-free stock. See, basically, if we take top 100 companies in the exchange, and out of that top 100 companies, approximately, I think 52 or 53 something, they are debt-free companies. I don't exactly remember. Might be 52, 53. I think the exact number is 52. Suppose if you invest in these companies as of today, you are very lucky that today's stock market, India is a 70-year-old company, and the stock market history is say of around 40, 45, 50 years or so. If you want to have a peaceful return and a good quality returns, if you're happy with, 15, 16, 18% CAGR, it is very, very easy for you to, as far as today's scenario, looking at today's scenario is concerned, to invest in these kind of stocks, say COVID-free or recession-free technological technology companies, say Infosys or TCS or L&T Infotech. They are COVID-free or recession-free stock, but still they are facing problems from their vendors for their payments. So COVID-free or recession-free stock cannot be there. COVID, as in COVID is there, COVID-free stock or recession-free stock, never. But these companies will perform because there is a one-time investment cost in this company. The recurring cost is very less. The recurring cost is only the employee's salary. And as in when they are curtailing their, and as of now, they're curtailing their costs, their margins would be increased and they would be able to give good returns to their investors. So personally, I feel technology sector or investment in technology sector will be a good investment. And even in the financial sector, other sectors will be there. Say, suppose if I give you an example, suppose if today Bajaj Auto or Hero Honda or Hindalco, they are utilizing their 100% capacity. And tomorrow suddenly they decide that they want to double or say increase their capacity, say around 10%, 15% or 25%. It is not that easy job. It is a very, very tough job because huge capex would be required. That is capital, huge capital expenditure would be required to invest. And the invest and the returns from this investment would be on a longer period. Plus, if you take other way, suppose today Infosys, it gets 100 clients. There's no need to invest in the additional 100 clients. There is no capacity as such in the technology driven companies. The capacity increases as and when the client adds or the requirement of the client increases. There is no need to, everybody is operating at their 100% capacity round the clock. Even if they get a number of clients, or today, suppose if I am a franchisee of Motilal Oswal or I am a stockbroker, do I need to invest anything else? Suppose if I open 25 or 100 accounts in a span of say 10, 15 days, no. Nothing. There is no investment cost to me. Same is with the technology-driven companies. But if as a chartered accountant or as a practicing chartered accountant, if there is a huge, say, 10 to 50, 15 to 25 big companies add up to your clientele ratio, then you'll have to invest in the other office space. You'll have to hire good employees. You'll have to hire chartered. So cost is also there. So that is the basic difference. The service, I would prefer technology-driven companies.
Thank you, sir. Now, what are the life lessons one can learn from stock market? I would like both of you to answer this question.
Life lessons. Life lessons from investing and trading in stock markets is only one thing. If you're an investor, be a patient investor. Invest in good quality stocks. Never take advisory from your friends who don't have complete knowledge, or just invest because your friend has invested or your relatives have invested in that stock. Invest in good quality stocks. Suppose and if suddenly there is a crash in the market, see if you take an example of last March 2020. The person, the people who had invested in the month of February or say last week of February, their investments were almost 50% down in a span of 3-4 days or a week, not more than a week or 10 days. Am I right, Anish?
Yeah.
But today their investments are doubled from the cost in the month of February, from their investment cost, not from the market, which have. I'm not giving the returns of the market. I'm just telling if they had invested in good quality stocks at that time, their investments are doubled in spite of the market crashing 40% in those 5-10 days. Whatever. So if you are an investor, be patient. If you are a trader, always might be anything. Keep your stop losses. Keep your stop losses on your screen, not on your mind. Because I have seen people, I regularly see people who keep their stop losses in their mind, but not on the screen. On the screen, that I mean to say, on the trade, they don't keep their stop losses on the trade, and that's why they end up making losses. And if you are gaining profits, don't cut your profitable trades. Keep your stop losses in profit, and the company is good. That is the basic life lesson that I would like to give it up to you.
Yeah. So my first lesson would be, and this is very, very important lesson, is have a plan. In market, you should have a plan before entering, your basis of entering, your buy, your exit. And likewise, in your life, the plan should include a purpose or a goal and reason as to why you have chosen a certain course of action over several other alternatives available to you. So when you go back and evaluate your plan, you can remember why you have made certain choices and why you have bought certain shares. So if everything goes well, stay the course. If things aren't going the way you'd like, of course, you can evaluate from other n number of alternatives available to you. Second is have a plan B. The thing is, contingency plans are always important, whether you're talking about investment decisions or life. A plan should always include what if I'm wrong clause. The third lesson would be the mean revision rule. See, in markets, there is a saying, trend is your friend. However, all trends eventually come to an end. The trick is to realize and recognize that when the trend has changed and prepare for it in advance. If you are experiencing a run of good luck, make provision when your luck turns. Chances are that it will at some or the other point. But if doesn't, you can always be rest assured that you are well prepared for it. So these are my three life lessons.
Thank you, sir. Abhijit, sir, which is your favorite scam?
Scam? Very tough question. See, at a very early age, I had personally seen the Harshad Mehta scam, because in 1992, I was in school at that time. But still at that time, I had an opportunity to visit the Bombay Stock Exchange ring. Personally, if you would ask anybody who is in the stock market or who has been investing from that time, the scam would be the Harshad Mehta scam. But as far as my personal opinion is, it wasn't the scam. He took the opportunity of the flaws in the system that everybody takes. He had an opportunity. He had that mind. So he decided, of course, it was a scam, but it was an opportunity that of the flaw that he, of the system that he took off, and he earned out of that. So my favorite scam would be the Harshad. I think everybody might have seen the Harshad Mehta. It is one of the best web series I've been ever made till now. So even after, before that series also, I was aware of that scam, everything, because I had very personally met Harshad Mehta when I had started my stockbroking business. Before that also, I had personally met him in his office only at Merriman Point. It was quite a few times I had met him. There's nothing, this thing. At that time, he was really the king of the stock markets. But as and when the scenario changes, after that Ketan Parikh scam was there, after that IPO scam was there, after that insider trading was there, then political scams. The scams are part and parcel. Today, in today's scenario, it is very, as far as the technological changes have been there in the system, it is very difficult or very tough today to create a scam. But unless and until the company who is in that business, they produce you the fake balance sheets, as Satyam did. Satyam was also a scam. As Satyam did, the fake balance sheets are there. So in today's scenario, it is very difficult to have a scam in the stock market or to this thing, because the margin requirements are very huge. The margin, so to operate a stock, you would be requiring hundreds and hundreds of crores. No doubt. Of course, yes, it might be happening today. I have no idea about it. But as of now, today, it is very, depending on the technological changes, it is very tough or difficult to have these kind of things today. And now everything is PAN and other base links. So at the click of a switch or at the click of a button, you get the complete, the government or the monitoring agencies get the complete idea of the person. But still, operation is can't be ruled out, and still today it is there in the market as far as I feel. But still, my favorite scam would always be the Harshad Mehta scam. Because the only thing is he had that skill to take the to grab the opportunity of the flaw in the system, and he had that much courage, and he dared to do that. So basically, that is the only thing, because of his mind. And I think you might, all of you might have seen the that series, and the person who is with Manu Bhai, that fat person. Do you know who that person is? Everybody knows. Today, who that person is? It is not correct to take the name of that person, but go on and research it. You will find who that person is. Okay.
If you both got an opportunity to correct some of your mistakes done by you up till now while trading, what it would be? Anish sir, can you go first?
What I'm going to tell you is going to be my biggest takeaway for you guys. See, the holy grail of trading is not making great profits, but it is keeping your losses small. I assure you, by keeping your losses small, the market will take care of the profits themselves. Risk management. That is the utmost importance in your trading journey. Lack of stop loss turns short-term traders into long-term investors. This is the biggest mistake which you can do, which I have also done. We have a tendency of booking profits hastily, but we let unrealized losses pile on for years and years with the hope that it will come back to break even. And what happens when it comes back to break even? We quickly sell it off and get rid of it. So basically, we lock in our money for n number of years with the hope of not having to realize any loss. So this is pretty bad. In the end, what you have is just a pile of losers making you regret every day, which you see in your portfolio. Thus, always have rules in place to book your losses. Apart from that, the second mistake I'm guilty of making is, see, whenever I have a profitable trade and whenever I book profits, and let's say there is a share with 10 share having a price of 1000, it goes up 20%. So many a times my mistake has been that I book profit at 20 when my system tells you. But let's assume in next 3 or 4 days, it goes again up for, let's say, again 10 to 20%. At that time, I succumb and I don't take any trades in that. So the thing is, there is a benchmarking which happens in your mind or in your psychology that, okay, I bought this share 1000 pe liya tha, 1200 pe और अभी ये 4000 है, तो भाई फिर अगर ये सिस्टम भी मेला बोल रहा है, टेक्निकल एनालिसिस भी बोल रहा है कि ये और ऊपर जाएगा, फिर भी जब तक 1200 के नीचे वापस नहीं आएगा मैं लूंगा नहीं. सो दिस इज माय सेकंड रिग्रेट. एंड थर्ड पॉइंट इज, आई वोंट से इट इज अ रिग्रेट, बट सी, एज आई टोल्ड यू, द फ्यूचर इज इन एल्गोस. सो हैड आई हैड द नॉलेज ऑफ कोडिंग, आई वुड हैव बीन मच अहेड इन माय रेस. सो आई वोंट से, बट आई एम लर्निंग नाउ, सो इट्स फाइन.
Anish sir, have you read the book Principles by Ray Dalio?
Yes.
You mentioned algos and all.
Yeah. Yes.
So, what are your views on it?
See, book reading will give just you the theory. Algos are actual implementations of code. So, the basic understanding would be to have a setup first. Because without a, see, the algos won't do something magical or won't give you like some magic mantra. What algos is do is they just automate what, let's say if you have a system that, let's say whenever a share comes down by 10%, I will buy, or whenever share goes up by 10%, you have to sell. So that is your system. So algos, what algos will do is it will just automate the system you trade on. So instead of you going and punching your buy orders and punching your sell orders, algos will do that on your behalf at a faster speed and at a quicker pace. So algos is nothing but your mind application which you have put in the computer. So computer itself doesn't give you a system. You have to develop it and it teach you. You have to teach it to the computer by coding. So basically, whatever system you have, that is automated.
Thank you, Anish sir. Coming back to our question, Abhijit sir, if you got an opportunity to correct your mistakes.
Suppose if I got an opportunity to correct my mistake, I would wish God if gives me the chance to buy Bajaj Finance at the rate of 99 rupees, which I had bought at that time. Not 99, I think it was something 68 or something like that. As soon as it got listed, but it's a very, very difficult that I would just advise that keep the, it would be not my advice. It should, I religiously follow nowadays to keep the stop losses in the loss making trade also and in the profit making trade also. And as and when
same can be said about Adani companies.
Very true. Just in a span of 3-4 days, the stock shot up by rupees 400. And I was advising my clients, rather my very good friends, had advised them that in the month of February, that's a live example, I had advised my three of my very good friends that they trade with me in futures. If you have the guts and if you have the daring to buy the Adani Enterprises stock, the target price would be around 2000 in a span of 6 months. But your daring, your guts and your daring should be that you should not be afraid. Jo bolte na, what we use, tumne hilna nahi chahiye agar wo 100-150 rupees bhi tootta hai to, because the lot size of that stock in the month of February was around 2000. Suppose if you trade in a future in Adani Group stock and if the stock crashes by say approximately 100 or 200, 100, 150 rupees, which is a very normal thing for a very, very high volatile stock, the M2M and the mark-to-market margin requirement other than the regular margin would be around about 2 lakhs, 3 lakhs or whatever it is. And it has happened from 1250 to 1078, then again 1200, then it has happened in the past 3-4 months. But once when it started in the span of from Monday to Friday, that stock shot up around rupees 4 to 450 rupees. But nobody waits. That's the only thing. Nobody waits for this kind of returns, at least in the futures trading. It is always better to keep booking up your profits whenever you trade in futures and to keep your stop losses intact on the screen, not on your mind. That would be my lesson from my end. If I get the opportunity to find a stock like Bajaj Finance, God should give me the strength to hold this kind of stock. God should give me that much strength to hold on to this kind of investment for a longer period of say 10 years or 15 years. But it is, I know it won't happen. It is very, very difficult and it is a very, very tough job.
Thank you, Abhijit sir. Thank you, Anish sir. It was great to have you here. Thank you for this insightful session and your valuable time. I am sure that everybody found it helpful. And thank you again.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Yes. Thank you for having us. It was a pleasure to have a discussion with you. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
So Aurangabad Vikasa will keep bringing such podcasts and with many more interesting topics. So stay tuned.